All right. Welcome to episode 90 of the CosCast. I am your main host, Pixie Dust Cosplay. And with me, I have my fellow co-hosts.
And the Bella Cosplay.
And the SA Cosplay.
Yeah. And we also have some wonderful guests with us today. Regina from Black Crane Creations and Linn from Linn Puzzle Art. Welcome, ladies.
Hello. Thank you.
So today we will be talking about art stance. That's the theme of the evening. But before we go into that, we usually go into a segment we like to call cosplay progress. So have we been working on anything cosplay related this week?
Oh, I must say no,
because not a lot.
I've had a math test, so
yeah.
Kinda. I mean, I washed my Hobbit shirt.
Oh, that works.
That works. Taking care of your costumes is also important, not just making new ones.
Yeah, I've done that too. I've washed one of my costumes.
Mm-hmm.
But I have not cleaned away the wigs from last weekend. They're still lying there. You can see the Mario hats. They're just piled on top of each other, and I'm like, eh, I'm going to take it tomorrow.
I cleaned them away earlier today, so... You're not that late.
No.
Yeah, I haven't been making anything cosplay related, but I have been making something birthday related since I'm having my Harry Potter birthday party next Friday. So I finished the Snitch.
Oh my god.
Nice.
It's awesome.
Such a pretty Snitch.
Yeah, pretty Snitch. So it's going to be a part of the decorations. And then I'm making like Hogwarts acceptance letter envelopes. So I just need to print some stuff and glue it on and write some things with ink.
And that's so cute. Too. Goddamn.
I love Harry Potter.
Yeah. I mean, look.
Yeah, exactly. let's see. Right. So, Regina, have you been working on anything?
Sadly, no. I've also just been refurbishing my new apartment.
Yeah, because you're redoing your kitchen.
Yes. Fun. Yay.
You sound so excited.
Oh, yeah, totally. sadly, no. I have a lot of big projects, but nothing I can advance on at the moment.
Okay. Well, we all have to have, you know, downtime sometimes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
We would know. We had downtime, like, for 6 months almost last year. All right. Before I forget, welcome to everyone in the chat. Thank you for joining us. So awesome to see that it's active and healthy. Hi, sweet Garu. All right. So let's go into the segment, which is called Cosplay and Geek Culture News.
Is it only me who has like sickening statics right
yeah,
now?
Yeah, I have. I just thought I wouldn't address it because.
Alrighty. Oh, no way.
Yeah.
Well,
I'm just going to try. Right, because if I mute Linn, it goes away.
Yeah,
it's coming.
It's
from
my
you.
Side. Damn it.
But we'll just have to try to deal with it.
Yes.
Let's endure.
So sorry to the audience if it's bothering you, but we're just going to have to soldier through. So first on my list of news is that YugiCon Graduation 2017 has a video that's been released. It was made by Kenneth Pedersen, which a lot of us in the cosplay community probably knows about. I think he goes by Kenneth Pedersen Videotography sometimes too.
He makes really nice music videos from conventions.
Absolutely. So it's out on his YouTube account, Kenneth Pedersen, so you should check that out. Because YugiCon was a very good convention this year, and we're sad we couldn't attend. But it looks like they had a lot of fun. Also, we want to mention that our episode 3 of our Dragon Age role-playing sessions is out on YouTube now, too. We live-streamed it on Friday this week, and it was a lot of fun. So everyone should go to Fateful Fumble on YouTube and check it out and subscribe, because there's a lot of stuff going on there, and it's lots of Red Lyrium and Templars and death magic and, you know, whatnot. Lots of cool things. And also our sister group, Betrayal Raven, who plays in the same universe and the same timeline in Theta's live streamed their second episode earlier today. So you can go check that out too if you're into tabletop role-playing games and live streamed role-playing games.
It was really fun.
We both watched it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Did anyone see the 1st of April, April Fool's joke that was played on Instagram by a lot of famous cosplayers?
You know what?
No.
Did not go to internet on April Fool's Day, so it wasn't purpose.
Right. Well, Ginny D and a lot of other big cosplay names made up a fictitious convention called DaoCon, and all dressed up in me costumes. Ooh. And wrote all over the internet, oh my god, I can't believe there are so many people copying my cosplay at DaoCon. I'm having the worst time. So pretty much trolling everyone on the internet. And I think a lot of people actually fell for it. So
they always do.
It's kind of funny. Yes. And our DM in Fateful Fumble posted something funny on Facebook the other day where it says, April Fool's Day, the one day where people are actually critical to everything they read on the internet.
Yeah.
Or not.
Driving.
Sad but true.
But
it is.
When I was a kid, I was always wondering how like adults would ever get fooled on April Fool's Day. How could you fool someone who's like 40 years old, who has, you know, experienced 40 April Fool's days before? And then it suddenly hit me yesterday that when you get older, you stop caring which day it is. But when you're a kid, you're like constantly looking forward to that day. Mm. So I think that might be the reason why.
Yeah, like you forget that April Fool's is a thing that exists.
Yes. Yeah. You would never do that as a kid. Never. Mm. That's like blasphemy or something.
Not as bad as forgetting Christmas, but still, I understand where you're coming from. The last piece, no, there's two pieces of news left. One is Ghost in the Shell is taking some heavy negative feedback.
Surprise.
Yep, and I can totally understand it in a lot of ways. I haven't seen it yet, so I can't really talk too much about it, but I understand the whole whitewashing allegation things.
Yeah, but the problem about that is that the Japanese people love the actress. I think she's perfect for the role.
So they're not offended, we're offended for them.
Yes. And that is the worst part about cultural appropriation, because great people are not the one who cares.
Yeah.
Right. Well, that is an issue. I don't know. It's always difficult to talk about these things. But I did read an article on CBR.com that Ingribis posted earlier this week that said that pretty much all of the main characters in the movie are Caucasian, and only, you know, like parts of Scarlett's crew are Asian, and they're only called up when she needs backup or things like that. So all of the minor roles have a lot of Asian castings, but none of the major talking parts.
But isn't that just typical Hollywood anyway?
Yeah, it is. But it's sad, still. That is that
of course it's sad.
Yeah, of course.
So yeah, so that's a topic of discussion that seems to be popular in the geek community at the moment. And last piece of news is that DesertCon have released some information about what's going to be happening on DesertCon this summer on the big, is it DesertCon 11 or 12?
12.
Right. Regina, you will be there teaching people about kimonos.
I will be having a small panel about, small panel about how to wear a kimono, different types of kimono, and also we'll be dressing up people that wants to be dressed up in kimono, and will also be able to take pictures.
Ooh, very cool.
Mm-hmm. To wear a kimono. Yeah.
Who doesn't want to wear a kimono? They're so pretty.
They are. They're wondrous types of clothing.
Yeah. Also have to admit, I know nothing about how you're supposed to wear a kimono.
You should definitely come to my panel.
Yes. Also, Melina Edwardson, also known as Superhero Girl Creations, will be holding a panel. They haven't said about what, but maybe superheroes, since that's her specialty, I'm guessing.
Or big fluffy dresses.
Yes, big fluffy dresses. She does that very well, too. And also, Galtvort School, the Hogwarts School, will be attending the DesuCon in the summer for the first time this year. So that's interesting news. And Radix Crew will be holding a dance workshop.
Oh, cool.
Very cool.
Very cool.
I have one piece of news, though.
Yeah, go ahead.
Because Rira in the chat was a doll, and she reminded me of the 100 Crones Challenge, which Martini's Workshop is hosting for this year. And April's theme, you could choose either between a Marvel character or Alice in Wonderland. So you're allowed to use stuff you have already have, and you're allowed to spend 100 crones max, or $10 maximum.
Yeah. How?
Well, it's to show like how to make a cosplay out of stuff that you already have, or recycle old costumes, or you just have to be creative and show that you can make awesome cosplay without it having to cost like a million.
Sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah,
it does. A lot of fun and a lot of work too. I really want to try to get into this challenge. I haven't had the time.
Yeah, me neither. I've had a lot of plans, but I just haven't completed them. So maybe I'll like do all of the months in 1 month or something.
Hey, huge shout out to Martini's Workshop, who's doing this for every month this year.
Yes.
Oh my god.
Impressive.
Mad cred, girl.
Yeah.
We from Fandomily Cosplay has sent in a request for a birthday shout out today. Shout out to Mead and Pheromony from Fandomily Cosplay. It's their birthdays today, both of them.
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday!
Yeah.
We love you guys. You're so fun and special and nice and sweet and kind.
Yes.
Yes. So that was all of the cosplay and geek community news for this week. So let's move into the main theme of the evening, which is art stance. So before we start asking you questions, I thought we would share some pictures of some of the stuff you guys work on and sell at your booths.
Cool.
So let's see. Let's start here. So we'll start with Black Crane Creations. You specialize in props, like horns and masks and things like that?
Yeah, most like that.
Yeah.
Actually, I prefer masks and horns because they're easily... You can easily add them to a costume without too much work. And they can be also very non-character specific.
Yeah. I mean, because if you go to a con, all you need is a pair of horns and a cute outfit and...
You're set.
Yeah, you're set. Mm-hmm.
It seems like your booth always is popular with people.
Well, it always seems like it, and especially at the big DesuCon last year, DesuCon 11, I was actually selling a crap load.
Wow.
It was so popular. I sold out everything the first day.
Wow.
I had to go home and make more. I did not sleep well that weekend.
Oh. That's super great. I mean, I don't think a lot of stands can say that they sold out on the first day. That's
no, not that many can. I know a few though, but yeah.
So let's see. This is a dragon mask and some antlers.
Yeah, there's a Sika there.
It's so beautiful.
They're from Japan. They're kind of small, so they kind of fit on humans' heads.
So you cast your horns based off of real horns.
Yeah, I always use a real antler or horn as a base and make a mold out of them.
Your apartment must be amazing.
Yeah.
Well, with a new apartment, I'm actually planning on making a whole wall just plastered with horns and
yes,
antlers.
Yes.
My trophy wall.
It's just like Kamui Cosplay has this wall with all her weapons. You should do this with horns.
It's in the works.
Yes.
Am I even designing the trophy plaques? You know, those wooden shields that usually have horns on and skulls. Making those for myself.
Awesome.
And now, actually, it's quite popular just for normal interior stuff.
Yeah, like interior board. Decorating.
A nice accent to give a little natural vibe.
Mm. Mm. Very Nordic design.
That too.
Here are some others. Yeah, these are so elegant.
So kudu antler horns. They're from a type of antelope that lives in Africa, and they're usually these are actually quite small. Mm. They won't usually get huge, and they're not the most best to have on your head. These, but they're really nice for fursuits though, and stuff that requires big horns.
Yeah, I bet they're heavy.
I guess they're quite. Could look like dragon horns as well.
Yeah, definitely. I'm actually planning on using a couple of these for a Kunari cosplay.
Ooh, that sounds cool.
That'll be awesome.
Yes, Ihadra, I guess she bought her horns from you, didn't she?
Yeah, I think she did, if I don't remember wrong.
Yes.
Cool.
And her Kunari is looking so good.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
So can't wait to actually see this costume.
I need pictures, Ihadra. Give me pictures. All right, this is the last picture I have gathered from your Etsy shop.
These are regular goat horns, very simple but also very popular because you never go wrong with goats.
No.
These are actually quite popular, especially around Halloween, actually.
Yeah, I can believe that. They kind of look like devil's horns too, so
yeah, they're really the classic horns. So that's why they're so popular.
Yeah, awesome. All right, moving on to this is one of my favorites of Linn's drawings because I'm a huge elf fan. and this is my favorite couple. This is like,
I love them too. They're just so precious in the series. It's unbelievable.
They're amazing. So yeah, enough about my ElfQuest fangirling.
Oh, good. I love this.
But there's a lot of them, actually, a lot of people who recognize ElfQuest and just go nuts. When I see it, it's awesome.
I bet you sell it. This is also one of my favorites because it's hanging on my wall behind me.
But Henry's is my bae. I love him. Yes. He's so tortured.
Yes. Give me all the tortured.
Yeah, of course.
Broody guys. Suniva has your Alistair poster.
Oh.
Yes. I think I have another one also with me.
Really?
Yeah, you bought Midna.
Which one?
Midna from Zelda, but I don't remember if that was one of yours or not. But
no, I think it might not have been. I think it might be back to us, actually.
Yeah, maybe. That's possible.
But I think so. But she's so talented, though. I really want her art as well.
Yeah, but I do for sure have your Alistair.
Cool.
Absolutely. All right.
Well, I loved him as well.
And
so.
This one, I just thought was so adorable, so I had to include it.
Oh, thank you.
It's
so old. Yeah, I totally forgotten I'd made it.
But it's still very your aesthetic. You're very colorful and bright and vibrant, I feel.
Thank you. Well, I love colors, so I'm very glad to hear that.
And this one. This one is really a new one that I watched the work in progress on this one. It was just very fascinating.
Oh, yeah, it's my current addiction, basically. I can't get out. Help me. This fandom swallowed me whole.
So, what's the name of the anime?
It's the one in the Seraph. Seraph of the End. It's basically just Angst City.
Ah, okay.
But I do love some angst, so it works. Yeah. Yes.
This is so perfect.
You're getting a lot of love from the chat, though.
Yeah.
I am? What? I get a bigger check. What the hell? Thank you, guys. That is so sweet.
Everyone is loving your stuff. Both of your stuff. I like that your handle on YouTube is Linn Makes Stuff.
Well, I thought it was very descriptive. It's just stuff.
<You're spot on. laughs>
Yep. It is very spot on.
I'm a master of words, so obviously.
All right, so let's jump into the questions. So I don't know, Anyosia, do you want to take the first ones?
Sure. Okay, we'll just you guys just answer Linn first and Regine, so just to have an order. First question: why did you decide to start having art stands at conventions?
All right. Well, I kind of had a craving and I went to all the art stands available and I didn't find the stuff that I wanted. So I thought, okay, I'm just going to make it myself. And maybe, just maybe, I'm going to find some people that like the same things that I do. Because it's a very good way to find other fans as well, not just show off your stuff, if you understand what I mean. Mm.
Totally.
So that was the main reason.
Cosplay works a lot in the same way. When you show up in a costume, people are like, oh my god, you're so cool, I love this show too.
And it's such a good way to just get all that fangirling out of the system, because it builds up after a while, right?
Yes, it does.
So that's the reason why I chose it. How Not to mention you... that is very...
Oh, what did you say?
No.
Okay.
No, nothing.
Go ahead, Regine.
Yeah. Well, I started with art stand mostly because... Well, I think I kind of have to start with how I started this in the first place, because originally I wanted to use horns for a costume. And I found these amazing, nice, curled ram horns, and I really, really wanted to use them, and I spent so much working on them, trying to fit them, to get away to have them on my head, but they were heavy, they were difficult to work with, I mean, the tools just died. And in the end, I just gave up and put it away for a couple of years. And then I realized that, what if I make copies of these? There has to be a way to do that, right? And I started watching around the web, and I found tutorials on how to make molds and such, and I just like looked at molds and tried, like, what can I do with these materials? What can I do myself? And I figured out, I can do this. I can get these materials. So I did. And I bought them and I tried them out, and it worked as I wanted to. So I just continued. And I ended up making a bunch of horns and also a lot of masks, because I was very inspired by a certain artist known as Miss Monster, which makes amazing masks. And I wanted to make some masks myself. So I did. And at the beginning, I just had an Etsy shop where I saw like a couple of, around 5 or 10 of them. And then I saw that, oh, there's an art stand option at Descon Fantasy, when fantasy was still a thing. And I got this table. It sold well. And I realized that what sold well was the horns. So I continued making more horns and acquired more horns. And I already had a few ready, so just went from there.
Cool.
And it ended up becoming my main income, because I had problems finding a proper job and I had some jobs on the side, but they weren't full-time jobs. So, yeah.
Cool. So this is actually your real live job now.
I think one of the first times I noticed you was when one of like the biggest newspapers, I think, in Norway actually made an article about you and your horns.
Yeah, that was actually Aftenposten. They actually contacted me on Bitraf, the makerspace I'm part of, where I have my workshop. And they were actually just scouting Bitraf to see if they had something they can make an article about. And they were there, they talked to people, then we didn't hear from them in a while, and suddenly they called me up and were like, dude, do you want to be part of an article? You want to like a small article about you? And I was like, sure. And then they were there and they took some pictures and they filmed me doing some casting stuff with a fancy camera, and then I didn't hear from them again. And then suddenly someone runs up to me with like a big mid spread of the newspaper, like, can you read the newspaper? I was like, what? And I was like, I thought it was just gonna be a small article on the net web page, but no, huge article on the front page and everything. And I was like,
awesome.
Hey,
that's crazy.
So it was cool. It was actually cool that people thought that my stuff was that interesting. So it was like, yay.
Yeah, because I don't think anyone else does the same thing as you do.
Not in the way I do it. I know some people who make costumes, and especially fursuits in Norway, do the same stuff, but they don't sell them. They usually do it for own gain and like for own projects. Mm-hmm. So I think I'm one of the first ones, at least, that does it at this scale in Norway. And maybe in actually of Scandinavia, I think.
Mm.
That was kind of fun.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
You found a niche, basically.
Yeah. I found a niche, and I hit it.
Very cool.
Nice. Okay. Next question. How much preparation goes into preparing for a convention?
Me first?
Yes.
Well, a lot. You definitely have to start several months ahead and just plan out what, for me, it's drawing. I need to figure out what I'm going to draw, how long it's going to take per drawing, how much free time I have to do it. And then I have to figure out how long it takes to print it because I send it to a professional place to get it printed properly. So I need to make sure that it gets shipped in time. So I have it before I travel to the convention. And it's just a lot of a headache, basically, to get it done in time. And I always forget something. Always.
Me too.
So, yeah, it's basically, I should have, like, lists to prepare. Just cross
have a list.
Everything.
Linn,
yeah.
Seriously.
I am such a ditch when it comes to lists. I just forget everything. But I think Regina is better at it, actually, aren't you?
Yeah, me and Frederick have really gotten it down to the list.
Maybe. Yeah.
Like have this huge long list listing everything we need to remember to actually bring to the convention and actually what we need to do in advance. And it's a long list.
Yeah. Oh my god, it gets longer every year.
Yeah.
It's just insane. But it's so much fun.
Do you need to make a list to keep track of your lists as well?
We should. Definitely.
But where do you order your prints?
Well, I have like a small place in Tønsberg that I just adore because, not because of the place itself, but because there's a person there that gets me, that understands what I need. And I've tried to like print in the same kind of store in other cities, but you can't find the same expertise there that you find like in when you just get that one person. So I need that one person. Basically.
I hate ordering prints online.
So. Yeah, you never know what you're going to get.
So many risks involved.
Yeah.
It's really nice to have a place where you know what you're going to get.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's just, it takes a lot of the pressure off because otherwise I don't know what I'm paying for.
Exactly, yeah.
But, yeah. Mm. But it's worth taking a risk sometimes just to see if the internet's places are awesome because I think, for example, Frederick has a place he prints from that is very good.
Mm. I don't remember which one that is though, but
yeah, I can't remember either. But it's good for him that it works. But I like mine, so I don't want to change right now. Mm. I get these really thick papers and everything is just exactly what I want.
Heavy paper and maybe semi-gloss.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I keep going, and I want this, and I want this, and I want this. So basically, I'm the worst customer. But but I really like the feeling of quality.
Yeah.
When you get a printed.
I think people can tell when they buy your prints because they are very,
I hope so.
Very sturdy, and you always have a plastic bag that you put them in to protect them and stuff. And I think it shows that you care about the quality of your paper.
I'm so glad.
All right, so Regina, how do you prepare?
Well, it's very similar to Linn, actually, but I have a different type of products that I need to create. For example, if I want to make new horns, then I'm able to have to actually get them in time, have time to make the molds, and then I have to experiment with how thick can I make the horns, how thin can I make the horns, how much material, blah, blah, blah. Then I also have to like order the resin and the foam and whatever I use to actually make the horns. And I have to order that from Netherlands, I think. Yeah, Netherlands and Spain. So it's not something I can actually get in Norway. So that takes some time. And it's the same process if I need to make, for example, a new mask, because that takes me a lot of time modeling. And modeling process can take everything from a month to several months, depending on how I feel about the design. It's a very tedious process. So I usually don't actually start with the actual making of the horns and masks before a couple of weeks in advance of the convention, because I usually have so many orders before that I can't really just have any chance of actually wasting too much resin and not having anything left for the customers.
Yeah.
And it's really, really hard to plan ahead.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Do you like shut down your Etsy store when you start working on things for conventions or?
No, I don't. I only done that once, and that was actually before Christmas, and I was having way too much going on that time, so I just had to take a break. But it's actually quite risky taking a break on Etsy because it would usually be like a month or two after that you'd like to sell nothing. Mm. I think it has to do with the algorithms how Etsy work. It's kind of risky. Not sure I'm gonna do that again. But yeah, I really have to make sure I have enough materials of everything, and that can actually be very hard to calculate, because sometimes certain types of horns are super popular and others are not, and certain colors are popular, and yeah, it's like that. So what I prefer for conventions, it's both a lot of long time in advance, and also just a couple of weeks where I just like do nothing but cast, paint, and put flowers on.
Yeah, you told us a rather funny story. Was it before cast, or did you tell this?
Which one was that?
The one about Desicon 10.
10?
Where you saw that. Or 11.
Yeah, you told that on the stream, not before the stream.
Good.
Short time memory.
Good story.
Yeah, but this was extreme, actually, because I had not planned to sell that much at all. So I had I think I had 30 or 40 pairs of horns, including masks, or like 10 different masks. And I was like completely empty at the end of the day, and I was like, oh fuck. And I'm very happy that I had my two friends, Helena and Greta, that watched the stand for me that coming days. I was there, but I was not in a fit state to communicate with my customers because I was like a walking zombie. So they were like fixed customers, and I was like, in
That's
a corner. Yeah, and the worst part is I sold out on the second day too. So I had to go home and make even more, so there was no rest.
Oh my gosh.
So I was like, why is this happening? And okay, it was a great sale and everything, so I hope it does happen the same thing this year, just that I'm better prepared with even more horns.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you have to make like 200 horns now, just to be sure.
Yeah, exactly. It's gotta be
good
heavy.
Luck.
In that way, it's actually quite nice that I don't have any conventions from now to then. It's like 3 months of no conventions, so I actually have time to work on different things.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
All right. Chris.
So it's a lot of work, basically. Lots of planning and list making and preparation and ordering and...
Yeah, actually, I've seen a lot of people being first time conventioning, and they had not become prepared at all, and usually missing everything. Like this. There was people who actually sell out the first day and are like, what? But they don't usually have that, bring that much stuff. And it's like, I'm so sad for them because like, should have started earlier.
Yeah, but I think it's also really hard to know if you're going to sell anything or not if you've never been there.
Definitely is. It's really difficult.
Mm.
So it's a risky market. You don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And I see a lot of people go in the same craft, or they're making the same things as everybody else, and I don't think that's a very good idea. I mean, some people can be really good at prints, and Linn, of course, as you can see, has a very popular style, and she's very talented. You are, Linn, you are.
You too.
Yeah, and I see like Frederick as well, Frederick Illustrations, he has a very unique style as well, and he's very, yeah, he has humor, and I think a lot of people love that. But I also see a lot of people who's like, they're very new to design and illustration and such, and it doesn't always go that well, and a lot of people are very demotivated by that, and sometimes you just have to realize that. I mean, I've been to lots of conventions where I barely sell anything, and I'm usually really down after that, but I know that I can sell really well on others, so yeah. Just have to, as it comes.
Sell. Yeah.
Alright.
Okay. What is it like to have an art stand at a con, and does it vary a lot from one convention to another?
Oh yeah, definitely.
Oh yeah.
Like all conventions have their problems, basically. And you have no idea what you're gonna get the first time you go there. So you just have to prepare, but you're never fully prepared. Like,
yeah.
For example, there's one convention that has all the stands in the main area, and when the show starts, all the lights go off, right? And it's an awesome con, but unfortunately, it's very hard to have a stand when no one can see you. But
so
they
you
are,
bring a lamp.
Yeah, they're very good at telling you, bring a lamp, because this is going to happen, and that is awesome. And as long as there's like a very good communication between the art stands and the conventions, things usually go extremely smoothly.
Yeah,
but there's always problems.
Always. It was like that at TotoCon last year, at least.
Yep. Yeah, but yeah, before that, like, it worked. It worked.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's interesting what can happen, what can go wrong, essentially. And there's a difference between Norwegian cons and, for example, Swedish cons in what can go wrong. There's like, because in Sweden they tend to like put you in tiny rooms.
Yeah, I have a story.
And that doesn't work. Yeah. No one dares enter into the tiny rooms because they feel like they're going into a place where people are staring. And they are.
Yeah, the worst thing that could happen is that someone would talk to you, you know?
Yeah, that is the worst.
Yeah, but seriously, customers are deathly afraid of talking to people.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
They go, they, like, they try to evade the stand if they can, if they see you in the talking mood. So.
Yeah, I'm totally guilty of this, but that's mostly because I'm like,
me too.
What am I supposed to say to people? I don't know.
I know. Yeah. And I just want to watch what they have, like, look at their stuff. I think at least the first time.
And it's not because you're not interested in talking to people. It's just something that is, like, terrifying about, oh, hi, I'm just looking at your stuff. Don't mind me.
Right.
I feel the same.
And yeah. And I mean, there's so many things to remember when you have a stand as well. It's like practical things, like bring something to cover your table with or something.
There are just sheets.
Yeah, there's so many things to remember. And if no one's told you what to do before you have a stand, there's a list. You need the list, basically. And you haven't made it and you don't know that it exists. So it's kind of
it's
part
like
of the
a
first
standard,
time.
Like an art stand list. Like, is this your first
stand? Yeah.
These are important things that you should know.
I think we should make one, actually. That would be very practical.
Yeah. But I want
always bring tape.
Nice story,
Eugene. Can you tell us your story?
Yeah, well, I was to Narcon last year.
Yeah, oh my god.
Yeah, that was a horrible experience.
Yes.
Linn and me were sharing rooms, so she saw it firsthand. Narcon completely misunderstood the concept of how you should put together an art stand area. Like, seriously, it was horrible, 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 horrible. And they decided to put in a building that had super tiny and crooked places. And first of all, they put the different art stands in sections so that those who produced physical things were in one section and those who produced art prints were in one section and so on. The problem with that is that I was put in a rinky-dinky, empty hallway where there only were like one or two people every 5 minutes.
No.
The first day. And it was just horrible. And the only reason I was moved to a better location, better with, you know.
Yeah, I heard that the tone said better.
Yeah, it was because the cosplayer Jayahan was there selling prints and photos and such. And she bitched so much about her bad location that she was moved to a better one. So I got her old location.
Lucky you.
Yeah, lucky me. The sales were so, so bad, and I mean, I barely saw people. Yeah, some people got in there, luckily me, but I mean, I tried to give them feedback, but honestly, I don't think they're going to listen, because I don't think
they care. I don't think there's anything to be done about the placement of the stands, because
I mean,
they choose that place every year, I think.
Yeah, another thing that really annoys me about the place was that the entire area was a big fire hazard. I mean, if a fire had broken out there, like, half the people would have died.
Oh, no.
Yeah,
that
and was I
was fun.
Like, there was so little room between the tables that you could seriously just get... If you were in a wheelchair, you could not get past.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it was kind of bad.
Yeah. So, I can rant about this for hours, I'm not going to do that, but...
Oh, we don't have hours.
Yeah, exactly. But that was the worst convention I've ever been to when it comes to an art stand. Right. They were like, okay, the crew was amazing. I mean, they were super nice and tried to help me and gave me food coupons and all that stuff. But it doesn't help when it just, you wasted so many thousand on this and it's like, yeah.
Bad NatCon.
Yeah, very bad.
And that didn't go well.
I'm not going back there.
Like, no.
Understand.
But seriously, like, for one thing I noticed is that big conventions aren't necessarily where you sell the most. For example, I was at the Unicorn Expo a few weeks ago. It sold really well. It was like over 120 visitors.
Hmm.
I had great sales. But I've been to DesCon Cosplay in Japan and DesCon Pop and barely sold anything.
But I think maybe with the smaller cons, when you do see people wearing your horns, that will kind of latch on to other people. So it's like, oh, where did you get those cool horns?
Yeah, I think so. A little bit of that. But I think it's also because it's difficult, because at big DesCon I can sell a lot. And there's a couple thousand people.
Yeah.
So I think there's a lot of different factors, but I'm not really sure absolutely what.
But I think maybe at big cons there are so many art stands that I think it's easy to just blend into the crowd unless you have a very distinct style or niche that you cater to.
Exactly. That's definitely true. A thing.
I also think that on bigger cons there are more people who are not cosplayers than on small cons. I think there are more cosplayers on cons who wants to buy props than on bigger cons.
That's definitely a thing as well. And also on bigger cons, some people feel like they're outside if they don't have like something costume. Because the first time I went to DesCon, I wasn't wearing a costume. And I felt like I'm not fitting in. So I wrote that the next DesCon I was going to, I was actually going to be a cosplay, and I did. So I think a lot of people are like, I want to cosplay, but how can I fix it here and now? Oh, look, someone is selling cool horns. Deal!
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm. That is true.
And Yossi, I think you have done this a lot at some cons.
Yeah.
Not wearing a costume, but when you leave at the end of the day, you suddenly turned into some Hogwarts character or... Yeah.
I like to buy, you know, props.
Yeah, me too.
I save time, and I think there are so many talented, artists around there that, you know, why not support the artists as well?
That is so true. And I mean, it's so important to just geek out before you go. You can't just not have like a nerd moment when you're at the con. You have to take a break and just go and admire stuff and go buy something.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it just, you're missing out, seriously. There's so many good people, talented people.
I miss out a lot too. As an art stand person, you actually really have time to go around and look at the other art stands.
Yeah.
And that really annoys me sometimes because, like, oh, wow, I'm going to look at that guy's person's stuff. And I was like, fuck, I run out of time. No, I can't do it. Damn it, I want to support him. That happened to me so many times and I regret it every time. And it's like, oh, damn it.
Yeah. I mean, if I had the money, I would probably buy something from every art stand at every con I went to be honest.
Very and dangerous.
Usually when I see something I really like, I go, oh no! Oh no! I want this, but I can't buy it. No.
Oh yeah, they've never done that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, and I have to interject.
You did that at BonsaiCon. Yes. You were like, oh no. It was like, what's wrong? I want this. It's like, shut up.
I just have to interject that Aninov wrote in the comment, am I hearing bark spawn in the background?
Yeah, yes. I heard it as well.
Yes.
I heard like soft snorting in the background.
I had to mute my microphone for a while because I'm having the TVs on. Just to give me some extra lights, and suddenly there was a picture of a horse there, and he hates horses. So,
that's a common
thing. Or maybe
he
just loves them so much that he's, you know, really frustrated. He can't get to it because it's on the TV.
Hmm. But he really didn't like the competitors at the Swedish Cosplay Championships either.
No, some of them he didn't like. Yeah.
All right.
You should become a critic.
Yeah.
Let's see. Okay, we can take next question before we run out of time. Let's see. How long have you been into art, and are you self-taught or both?
Both. And I've basically just drawn since I was able. Like, my mom and dad used to just buy like a giant roll of regular paper and just roll it on the floor and say, go out. because otherwise I draw on the walls and everywhere. So just they were just taking precautions and just letting me get out everything I need to draw. So basically all my life, and I've had some training, but mostly self-taught. And I'm studying design right now, but that's mostly just product design, like technical drawing. So it's not the same style that I usually draw in. It's basically more squares. Mm. Square on top of squares.
Technical design.
That is not as much fun. That's not as much fun.
There's no purpose.
Mm. Yeah, it's very functional. It's perfectly functional.
It sounds a lot like my background too. I was a very easy child to handle. Give me paper and crayons and I could sit still for hours.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It's so much fun.
Yeah. So most of my childhood I was self-taught, and then I took a bachelor's degree in illustration, and
cool.
After that I did nothing.
But I think that's a very useful thing when you're starting out drawing. Like, just go for quantity instead of quality.
Yeah.
Just do as much as you can, as quickly as you can. Don't worry about the results.
Because things will develop as they go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. So it's smart to do it that way.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. It comes in handy when I do stuff for the CosCast.
Yeah.
Graphics and stuff.
We need to see more of your art.
Yes.
Thank you.
You know, we could definitely make an entire episode about, you know, just making art.
Yes, let's.
Let's do that next time.
Yeah.
Next time. My God, that would be so much fun.
Yeah.
But how would you know about Regine and her?
Yeah. How did they get into it?
I always grew up with lots of costumes. My mother made a lot of costumes, and for like every not Halloween, but the carnival, I always was a new beast, or I was a turtle, an Indian. Viking, a bat. I was a lot, so I always like been okay with costumes. But one part was, in the beginning, I actually kind of looked down at cosplayers because I thought that, oh man, the costumes are so bad. I was like, I don't know why, but I really felt bad. But then I met my boyfriend, and he actually had a couple of years of cosplaying behind him. He actually won, it was second or third place at DesCon as Angeal from Final Fantasy VII Crisis Core. Mm-hmm. And I actually took pictures of him a couple of years before we met. So I have pictures of him in costume at DesCon.
Wow.
Kind of funny.
It was meant to be.
Exactly. But then I met him and was like, man, I want to do cosplay too. And then I was Freya from Final Fantasy IX, and I actually won a prize for that costume on my first convention.
Oh, congratulations!
I was like, yay! And I was like, wow, this is kind of addicting.
Yeah.
Continue. But I mean, I always been happy working with my hands. I went 3 years at Tegning for Mofarge, at 1 year at Sogn, and 2 years at Elvbakken. And I really enjoyed, I did most of the drawing and such, and I still have I still draw a webcomic, not a very special one, not a very well updated one, but I like drawing and doing art. I always been surrounded with especially art with my parents who collect antiques. So I always had like that input with pictures and everything. So I always wanted to do something with that on my own, and well, I just got the chance. I wanted to do it. But I've always been very self-taught. I never actually liked it when other people are like, you have to do this, you have to do that. And I'm like, I have to do this.
I agree. That's totally my aesthetic as well.
That's why I really, really hated it when I went to Italian for Borgia, because it was like, you have to do it like this. And I'm like, but that doesn't look good. And I don't like that style. And it always frustrated me when people were going pencil drawings. And I always had, there was always exaggerating the shadows because they looked cool, and like, that's how you do it. I was like, no, that doesn't look like how it does in real life. So I was like, fuck that. And I just went with my own style, and it's not as good as Linn's. I never managed to like,
it's don't not lie.
Linn, come on.
Lying.
I think we all have this feeling. I mean, when I look at this stuff, I also think, oh my god, I'm total shit.
Yeah, I think that as well about my own drawings. It's just, look at that mistake there, look at that mistake over there. It's just, yeah, I think you only see the mistakes when you draw, basically. Yeah. You can't see how much you've progressed.
Yeah.
But it's like that, and I always wanted to create, ever since I was a kid. So it was like costumes, whatever, props, just something to do with my hands. So I actually went 3 years of game design.
Cool.
I'm actually a game designer on paper.
Tanya, haven't you also started game design?
Yeah, 1 year.
So you have something in common.
Yay!
What was it like? What kind of stuff did you do there?
Well, game design is not as much as visual as it is how games work behind the scenes.
Right.
It's a lot of how to design worlds, how to design how the game works and controls. It's not the graphical part, and that's a lot of people who misunderstood that thinks it's the actual graphical part.
I see.
That was actually how I met my boyfriend too, which is a game programmer. Yay! So funny how that works. But it's still interesting to know game design because you don't understand how games are built, and it's not that easy as it looks. Trust me. Mm. And that also makes me a very big critic because I'm like, this could have been done better. So whenever I play a Dragon Age game or a BioWare game in general, I'm like, man, those animations are horrible. Why does that hair look like wood? Seriously, it looks like you just pop it off.
Yeah.
And that's one of the bad things about having the game designer, you know, because you're like, you see all the errors and no one else notices, and it's like, god damn it.
Yeah. But I think all do that with different fields. I have the same thing with hair, because I'm a hairdresser. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, cinema, what? You could definitely do, you know, your own art stand, like hairdressing art.
Yes, stand. You should. You should stand it. That would work.
Do you need cool hair? Come visit us. We can do everything. We have an artist. We have a game designer. We have a hairdresser. Go nuts.
Diversity.
Yeah. Perfect.
No, that's not horrible.
I know, we're running out of time.
Yes, we are. We need to.
Bad.
Yeah, but thank you so much anyway for having me. It was a lot of fun.
We have a few questions more, though.
Yeah, we're going to continue.
Okay,
so we just need to move it along.
Give it to us.
First of all, I think this is a quite important question. Just, you know, quick answers. What inspires you?
Oh my god, so many things. Like games, art history, television things, real life, people. Like, if you talk to a lot of people, you get, like, extremely good ideas after a while. But I think, like, you just get a lot of inputs whenever you go, no matter where you go. And, like, yeah, basically art history mostly is my biggest inspiration, I think. Mm. All that weird shit. But, yeah. What about you, Regina? Do you have,
it depends on what it is.
Special?
If it's for my store, my art stands, and it's for horns, I have to say that horns, and what fascinates me, I'm always fascinated by horns and antlers, is that the natural part of them that is so mathematical. I mean, all horns follow a spiral. Mm. All antlers follow a certain mathematical kind of how they grow and symmetricalness and all that stuff, and it's like so fascinating. It's like, oh man, nature did this, and like, there's no special stuff behind it, and the texture, and it's like, oh, it's weird. And when it comes to masks, most of my masks are inspired by Asian, especially Japanese, Korean, Chinese style. So all that kind of art is always inspiring me greatly.
Mm.
But inspiration can be almost anything. And especially like Linn, it's places, it's things, it's other art, other people. It's a very difficult question because it can be anything.
Yeah, but now that you mention it, like, for example, Japanese art and animation, like the clean cut way they draw buildings and people and just make everything look so smooth and light in a way, it's so fascinating to see how they do it.
But me, I'm actually the most thing that fascinates me most about Japanese art is more older art, not really, not as much anime and such things. But if you look at old Japanese, just small everyday objects, they're so skillfully made to replicate animals, plants, natural phenomena and stuff like that. And all of them are so intricate and beautiful and so skillfully placed, and you don't really see that in other types of art around the world. I mean, Chinese is just the complete opposite. It's all gaudy, very lots of details that are not necessary. But the Japanese one is so simple, and it's like, it's so pretty. And then, like, some things when I see them, I just want to cry.
I hear you're really passionate about this.
Yeah, sorry.
I don't know.
It's the same thing with them. But I collect kimonos, and I really love the kimonos with the classical Japanese symbolism, and not exactly symbolism, because symbolism in Japan is everything. It's like everything can be a symbol, just because everything represents a type of feeling or time of the year or whatever. So it's they just mastered it. I'm jealous. Very I want cool. to do that too.
So Niva, do you want to take the last three questions?
Yeah, I know we've you've answered just a little bit of this already, but just a quick summarize of it anyway. What kind of materials do you guys work with, and what are your favorite / most used techniques?
Oh, that's fun. like watercolors, aquarelle, that is the best. I used to do that a lot before I discovered digital art. And digital art takes like half the time, so of course I'm going to do that more. but I'm really in love with ink and how I can use that, especially like ink from squids, because it tends to get a little bit brown afterwards, and if you like dilute it with water and stuff, it becomes very beautiful. Yeah. And it's gorgeous to look at when it's done. So that is probably my absolute favorite to do, like ink work. But it takes forever, so digital. What about you, Regina?
Well, I mostly work with silicones and resins to make the molds and the casts, and also expanding foam. And for modeling, I use monster clay, which is a type of plastiline-like clay, which is just the best thing in the world. It's when you melt it, you can melt it at 70 degrees, and it becomes completely liquid. And that means you can like shape it however you want. And when it hardens, it becomes hard. As when it cools, I mean. And then you can just carve it, you can like work with tools, you can even heat it up, just some parts of it using a heat gun. I mean, it's so versatile, you can use it again and again and again, and it's the best thing ever. And I need more people need to know about it, damn it.
Yeah.
Because there's so many other fairy clays on the market, and they're like, oh, but it's cheaper. Yeah, but it sucks. You're supposed to buy it. Seriously.
Where do you buy that?
I usually buy it from a website known as formx.eu. They're from Netherlands, and they have like everything you need for casting, molding, and modeling. They are the best. Sadly, they are also quite crappy when it comes to service, but you get your stuff eventually. They have the best selection I've ever seen in Europe, because they have a lot of stuff you can't get. That's only in the United States, for example. So you have to buy it from them or from eBay, and I prefer them. Definitely. So formx.eu, go there, use it, love it.
Good tip. Do you have any good tips for people who would like to learn more about art or prop making?
Yeah, basically. You first.
Whatever. Okay, go on. The first thing is you might want to browse around the internet and see what other people have done. Not necessarily ask people how they do stuff, because I think a lot of artists are really tired of that. So it's just better to just search for tutorials and just have a look, especially YouTube. It's great. Even though a lot of things can seem very complicated and unnecessary, if you ask me, the best thing is just to browse around, try to think, how can I solve this? How can I make a mold for this? How can I model this without making problems? Mold making is a lot about being creative, because it's not usually one way to do it. For example, I have to make a different mold for antlers than I do have to make for horns. They're two very different shapes. So stuff, that's actually my biggest tip to people who want to start the same stuff as I do. You really have to be very good at problem solving and just finding tutorials and just learn from others, those who are willing to learn other people, of course.
Yeah, and learn from yourself, I guess.
Exactly. Yeah. I learned so much in the last 3 years. You have no idea.
Yeah. As for me, just don't go for perfect, because all the artists I know are basically perfectionists, and they hate what they make a lot of the time because it's not what they picture in their minds. And it's me too as well. But it's very important to just finish stuff. Don't get caught up in thinking that I can't finish this because it's not perfect. I should just put it away until I've gotten better so I can like do it perfectly. Just do as much as you can and don't judge yourself too hard in the beginning, because everyone has felt the same. Just draw what you love and draw as much as it is that you can. Because that tends to work. And then you can like expand from your comfort zone, because that's just also very important. Mm. Like, do the thing that scares you. Like, once a week, just do the thing. And you should probably end up doing just fine.
Very good advice.
Very. Do the thing.
And like Yurai Art says in the chat, don't say sorry for things you love. If you love it, you love it.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. Mm-hmm. Just be the fangirl that you want to be.
Yeah, she wrote that about the kimono collection. It's good to be passionate about things.
Yeah, but it's true.
It is very true. Do you guys have any good beginner tips about how to get started with art stamps? Like, what kind
with
of
art stamps?
Yeah, what kind of conventions would be a good place to start?
Well, should I name names, maybe?
If you
or should
to.
I just be general? Because I kind of like Torikon, for example, because they have such a good dialogue going with the art stands. You can always go to the people and say, help me, something didn't work, what should I do? And they're there because they have like a person that is very dedicated to making things okay for the art stands.
I agree to that.
Yeah, so I really like that con as a first time goer, because I've been there not too long ago. And I was going to say Banzai, but Banzai has sadly taken a little break.
Yeah.
JumaCon is kind of nice, actually. It's very small, but I think it might be a good trial run. If you're not certain you want to try, it's a good like testing area. And then you might notice if you don't have like box for your money or not like essential things that you need for the bigger ones, if you know what I mean. Mm. What do you think, really, Gina?
I think it's actually the same thing. Like, Unicon was a very good starting con, because the tables are cheap, so you don't lose much if it doesn't sell. And that's actually very important, because I see a lot of people do the mistake that they buy a huge table, really expensive, and then they end up not being able to sell even what the stand costed, what the price was. And that's... a lot of people do that mistake, so just start small and then scale up. And you can try any convention you want, but you should try to aim into a convention that fits what you're trying to sell. So, for example, for fantasy-related things, you should try like conventions that have like a big fantasy population. BlizzCon had that before, but they're not that much anymore. It's more for the smaller cons like Turicon and Banzacon have a bigger fantasy.
And about ArthaCon was recently, and I think you were there, Linn.
Mm-hmm. It was awesome. It was very good.
And they're free for art stamps. Yeah.
And I was going to say, if you find a convention that is near you as well, go for it. Then you won't have to worry about hotels or anything, and just if it doesn't work, you can always go home.
Yeah.
But hopefully it will work.
Because the worst part is when going to a convention like we did with Artcon.
Yeah, Nikon.
Nikon, sorry.
Yeah. No, I know what you mean.
Yeah, it was 3 days, like 4 days actually. It was just like, I want to go home, I hate this, wah.
Yeah.
And it's not a fun thing to do. So I definitely...
No, it's very stressful and it doesn't go well.
Yeah.
You just...
So start small, then go big.
Yeah.
Good advice.
Definitely. And if you have people going there as well, if you know the people going, like if you have some friends, make sure to have someone that can like take care of your stand if you need to go somewhere.
Yeah, definitely. So it's like someone pop in and just if you have to go to the toilet or get some food and stuff like that.
Yeah, because it can be a little bit weird if you know no one at the con at all. Then you're gonna feel very exposed for a little while.
Yeah.
And if you can't bring an assistant, because some people have assistants.
That is the best.
Yeah, it's always good to have assistants.
Especially when you bring as much as you do, when you have horns.
Well,
so many suitcases.
I mean, your suitcases weigh a ton. I tried to remember.
Ugh, so heavy, I know. Paper's heavy.
If any of our viewers have any questions for you guys afterwards, would you be open to answering questions if they send you messages and stuff?
Of course. Yeah.
Okay. So there you go. If any of you have any questions that haven't been answered yet, feel free to ask Linn or Regina, and they can try to help you out with that.
Yep. No problem.
Absolutely.
Awesome. You guys are so kind. That was our entire, that was our script, all our questions, and you've answered them really great, I think. So the last segment of the evening before we say goodbye is Geekery, where we ask if any of us have watched, read, listened to, or played anything interesting this past week that you would like to recommend to our viewers.
I started watching Iron Fist today, and it's really good. I've watched like 5 or 6 episodes just today. It's because I can't move much because my I've sprained my ankle, so you can see like it's bulging.
Ow, I know that hurts.
Yeah, it hurts like
you're bedridden.
Yeah.
Basically.
Yeah. So that happens when you party too much.
Oh no.
And go with high heels.
That's why you don't wear high heels. Yay!
Yes.
But you looked lovely at the party though.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Yes, I have so much to recommend, or at least one thing. Ha! And that is Zelda Breath of the Wild. It's so amazing!
Yeah. It looks so good.
It's amazing. I love it. So much, in fact, that I played some of it this weekend. You know, it was supposed to be me and my boyfriend playing it together, so we got kind of mad at me.
Oh.
But I couldn't help myself. I was all alone. I just wanted to watch, you know, stuff and, you know.
You wanted to have fun, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If he doesn't like it, that's too bad for him. He chose to go away for the weekend.
Now he can play it when you're at work or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah. Anyways, and I also recommend playing Dragon Age Origins, even if you have done it before, because it's cool. And yeah, I think that's about it right now.
Cool. Sample says Hannibal the series in the chat. I've seen it.
It is so good.
And Cecilia says 13 Reasons Why.
Is that an anime or is it a?
I haven't seen it.
It's on Netflix. It's a series,
okay.
I think.
Okay, cool.
It's creepy.
She says it may be triggering for those who are sensitive to suicide and rape, which they have warnings on in certain episodes. But if you can, you should all watch it because the world needs shows like that. Okay. Cool.
Okay.
I will check it out. I'm intrigued. Ronnerov says, I've been listening way too much to the dubstep remix of Mage's Pride track from Dragon Age 2.
What is this?
I need to hear this. Send me a link.
Oh my god. Yes, link, please.
Too bad the links won't work in the chat, though.
No, they don't.
Oh no, that's true.
But send it to me on Facebook. Message. And I'll spread it around. Everyone can hear it. This sounds too good to be true.
I'm just gonna search for Mage's Pride and dubstep and I'll probably find it.
Yeah, exactly.
We have a huge Dragon Age fan base in our viewership.
Excellent.
All the Dragon Age.
Dragon Age is so good.
Yeah. Addictive.
Yeah. I'm really, really looking forward to the fourth installment. I mean, are going to you know where. Oh, it's gonna be amazing.
I wanted
it's
no.
Gonna be so cool.
But
we're gonna have to wait for years. I just know it.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, sadly.
But it's gonna be worth it.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, if Fenris doesn't come there and do some seriously payback to certain people,
yeah,
I'm so gonna be disappointed. Fenris,
yes, I want Fenris to be in this game.
Yes.
Always Fenris.
I haven't met Fenris.
You'll meet him. You'll see.
Yes. Just wait.
Yeah.
I've been binge watching AKB 0048 because Cecilia is not letting me forget to watch it. So I finished it now. It was great. I love it.
And she also put up the video of her and her group, the Kiraras, dancing from the series today. So
her unicorn, super cute. Everyone should check it out on her YouTube channel, Cecilia Hansen. And oh, Himedera says Attack on Titan is back, which I'm super excited about.
But it came out on the 1st of April. I was just like, just what?
Sure, are they still on April Fools?
Yeah.
I'll say how long we were waiting for it.
Yeah, exactly.
Too long.
Yeah, wait long.
Absolutely.
Yes, Cecilia, I saw both seasons. I have finished all of AKB. Are you proud?
No spoilers, please.
No spoilers. No. I will not say anything. I will not steal the feels.
Thank you.
Awesome.
And yes, we've been playing role-playing games a lot lately because we've been live streaming it, and it's just so much fun. And other people in our social groups are starting to play too, and it's super fun.
Yeah,
everyone should roleplay.
Yeah, honestly,
roleplaying.
Best thing.
And then you start with LARPing, and then you need horns, then you come to me.
Right? Yeah, it's a vicious circle.
I'm rubbing my hands here in glee, like.
Or you need some risque fan art, and you go to Linn.
Ooh.
Yay! Yeah.
Win-win. That's how we do it.
Oh, man.
And
yes, exactly.
All right. Linn and Regina, do you have anything else you want to recommend?
Yeah, actually, I've binge watched Westworld.
Ooh.
And it is so good. Oh my god, I can't believe I haven't seen it before. But it has a lot of dark stuff in it, so if you're triggered by like death or abuse or mind fuckery or something, it's gonna be bad.
Aww.
But it asks really big questions about what is humanity and everything, so it's very philosophically interesting. Hmm. Worth the watch.
Absolutely.
I would actually recommend that if you don't like the new Ghost in the Shell movie, I would actually recommend you read the original manga. Not the anime, because the original manga is completely different than the anime. Oh. A lot of people don't know this because the style is different, the story is different, only the same thing is kind of some of the themes and the name of the main character.
Interesting.
Yeah. Because I don't remember his name right at the moment, but the artist is actually known for having a lot of humor and he loves making very sexy characters. So there's a lot of boobs and angles and all that stuff, but it's more tasteful. It's not that bad. He also made the series called as Appleseed, and I actually recommend that one too if you love mechs and robots and all that crap. So I would actually, yeah, go read the original manga. It's worth it.
Cool. I like this.
Very cool.
And Cecilia would like to recommend Big Little Lies. She says it's very good.
Well,
I haven't seen it, but I've seen a lot of posters for it. HBO are promoting it very hard. Okay, well, I think that pretty much sums it up then.
Yep.
All right, thank you to Regina and Linn for coming
to
the show. It's been a pleasure having you on. So you're welcome to come back anytime you like.
It was a lot of fun. Thank you for having us.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
And thank you to our viewers for watching. Yeah. It's always lovely to have you here. I don't remember what next Sunday's episode is, but I will let you know as soon as I can figure that out. And we'll see you next Sunday. Bye.
And bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Yeah.